Are you dead gum government? You saw it so and so's. You got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes. Where you dead?
Good morning, Muskegon. This is I on Muskegon, and I'm Jim Riley here in Muskegon's Clear Channel Studios with my friend and engineer, the legendary Oscar Osbo. And we welcome all of you in radio, computer, smartphone, and podcast land to I on Muskegon. And, of course, we are Muskegon's number one rated political talk radio show. We continue that into 2012. And, of course, we are the show that wants to put you on the radio. We haven't been super live this year, but we are live now. And our phone number is 231-830-3109. Give us a call. We want to put you on the radio. And, of course, I'm here with Oscar, but I'm also here with Susie Hughes. Susie's been on before. Good morning, Susie.
Good morning, Jim.
And, of course, you, in addition to being a really smart lady, you bring some other credentials with you. You're a past chairwoman of the Muskegon Republican Party, the vice chair of the Michigan 2nd Congressional District for the state Republican Party, and you are the current chairwoman of the Muskegon Tea Party, and you're a gun owner and a shooting champion. And
that's right.
You are ready to rock and or
I
roll.
I am. Ready to go.
Don't mess with Susie.
Not mess with that. Boy, that is the truth. If you're ever thinking of a place to break into, find another one.
I would highly recommend that.
I think we can all agree on that. Today is January 8th, 2012, and as I said, it's the first really live show. We did the January 1st show. We recorded it. It was a new show, but it wasn't live, and we are live today. And today we're going to continue, as the show will throughout most of this year. We're going to focus on Muskegon and West Michigan, and we're going to focus on the politics and the political decisions that are made by the elected and appointed folks who make big spending decisions that will affect us. And they also make promises, and they come up with good ideas and in some cases bad ideas. We want to find out how those ideas, how their votes, and how their power and clout is going to affect us little folks here in Muskegon County and in West Michigan as a group. We're going to get into some specifics shortly, but I like to start off with some hot topics that kind of caught my eye during the last week, or some things that are coming up. And one, you know, this is a political year. The news has been very, you know, super-duper focused on the Republicans and their quest nationally for their presidential candidate. And, of course, we will have an opportunity here in Muskegon County and the entire state of Michigan at the end of February to vote, assuming there still is an open campaign, assuming it hasn't been decided by then. But at the end of February, which is February 28th, we will have our primary. So keep that in mind. But this is kind of a time, you know, folks like to talk about New Year's resolutions and doing things that will make your life better and hopefully make your family's life better. And if you've got children, grandchildren, and the like, make that better. And one way that you can, without having any special tools, without having any special clout, and without any really significant effort on your part, but it will make a big difference, and that is to get a little more involved in the politics and the political decisions in your own community. And one way to start is tomorrow, which is Monday, January 9th, the Muskegon County Republican Party will have their regular monthly meeting. Those meetings are at 5:30. For the winter anyway, they will be at Fricano's West Restaurant, which is on 1050 West Western Avenue. And everyone is welcome. You don't need to know a big high-level politician to go. You are welcome to attend. Now, I'm not on the this will be a shock to folks. I'm not on the list for the Democrat Party of Muskegon County. So I don't know when they have their meetings, but I'm sure that they have theirs also, and I would strongly recommend everyone, if you are interested in either, if you are of the left or of the right, to attend those meetings. And that's a way, you know, you can...
Is there a way to find out about that?
They do have a website. The Muskegon County Democratic Party does have a website.
Had I thought about that, you know, I in the past I've Googled it. Just Google Muskegon County Democrat Party.
They meet at the CIO Hall.
Yep, and they meet at the Union Hall, so there is a pretty strong union connection there, in case anybody was wondering. But, you know, I would imagine folks on both sides of the aisle, at least us little folks on both sides of the aisle, it'd be interesting to go see, assuming you're welcome to attend a Democrat Party monthly meeting, and I can
They're open to the public,
folks,
too.
Mm-hmm. Folks are welcome at the Republicans.
Except
just to
you.
See how it works. Well, I'm I have been less than warmly embraced on occasion, but I am welcome to attend, and I will be there. I expect to be there. Couple of other things. You know, there's been a lot of talk about this the United States Congresswoman. I don't recall her first name, but Giffords.
Gabrielle Giffords.
Gabrielle. Got a beautiful first name. And, of course, she was shot almost a year ago, and much has been and will likely be made about her recovery and the like. But I think one of the things that ought to be considered as we get into this election cycle, and of course they're harsh words, or at least the media will say they're harsh words, but frankly, more often than not, it's just truth saying, you know, this is how you voted, that type of thing. But there had been much commentary about civil discourse, and you're not allowed to say this or say that. And of course, the Tea Party was at first blamed when this poor congresswoman was shot, and others obviously were killed. And I think it's important to remind everyone that the media has a very strong bias, and it most certainly is not in favor of the Tea Party or conservatives in general. And I will just read a comment right after all the demands for civil discourse were shouted at us a year ago. This is a comment from Representative Mike Caputo, who is a United States congressman, Democrat from Maine. Quote, I'm sorry, Massachusetts. I'm proud to be here with people who understand it's more than just sending an email to get you going. Every once in a while, you need to get out on the streets and get a little bloody when necessary. Now, that's a pretty aggressive comment. It came from a Democrat, so you probably didn't hear it. I think that we do want to have civil discourse, and I think it's critical that we have discourse. But remember that when you hear comments coming about the Tea Party as opposed to coming from the Occupy Wall Street, which has been vile, the Occupy Wall Street has just been a very intrusive group. They've been quite loud and noisy, and I would say not very civil on occasion, only on occasion here in Muskegon. And just keep in mind, I know that the Muskegon Chronicle and the national media will be first to jump on things said by the right, by people in the supporting Republican candidates. But if you allow folks like this Democrat representative to get away with this type of language, if we allow the Occupy Muskegon folks to disrupt meetings when our senators Hansen comes in town, or when the Republican state representative Hansen has, or Holly Hughes has her meetings, or we're going to have now these Republican candidates for the state Senate, for the U.S. Senate, challenging Debbie Stabenow. They're going to be coming into town. So just be aware. The other side is prepared. The other side is having their leaders say, once in a while, you need to get out on the streets and get a little bloody when necessary.
That so, doesn't sound like peaceful assembly.
No, it isn't. It isn't. And we know where they're coming from, at least too many people on the left who are demanding essentially the taxpayers pick up the spending for their pet projects, in many cases like the Chevy Dolt, what are they having?
You love that car, don't you?
Well, you know, I hate it because it's a symbol of what's wrong in the world when essentially governments control the manufacturer, mm-hmm. and they ally themselves with the unions, in this case bail out the union of an automobile. And just like we've seen with the Solandra, which was the $1 billion or $500 million bailout, or not bailout, it just sucked right the tax dollars right out,
right.
For this solar panel company that was a disaster, and truly one of probably dozens that have already happened. But the Chevy Volt is a symbol to me of truly what is wrong with this country, $7,500 per vehicle in a tax credit. I mean, this is a tax credit.
But you and I
credit.
Give somebody to buy that car.
Well, the average person who buys a Chevy Volt is earning somewhere in the neighborhood of $120,000 a year. These are not poor people. Why, you know, it's funny. The people on the left who are supporting this electric vehicle fad, if you will, and who are running around saying the rich people shouldn't be getting bailouts and this kind of thing, they have absolutely no problem. I've never heard anybody on the left complaining about why are we giving $7,500 tax credit to people who are, by any definition, well-to-do, if not rich.
And I didn't see them complaining about putting the parking free parking places for them down there to charge their cars. Either.
Exactly. Yeah, the free parking paid for by your tax dollars at the county building at the parks.
Not to mention the I shouldn't say poor people, but the middle class pretty much need those type of cars to. Those are the ones that I would think that would need those type of cars to save money as far as gas and
right.
You know.
And they're not even affordable to that.
They're not affordable to that.
Well, of course, they're not affordable because they don't make any sense today. As a matter of fact. In many cases, the new vehicles coming out, be they diesel or gasoline, are getting in the 40-plus miles right. per gallon. But in any event, no, I don't like it. And what's interesting, though, all 8,000, funny thing is they've only sold 6,000 of these disasters. The math has been done. The right. average government subsidy is in the neighborhood of $250,000 per vehicle sold. But they've manufactured 8,000 of these, and it turns out now that they've sold 6,000. And but the batteries are quite dangerous. The engineering, because this thing was politically driven, the engineering just is not sound. As Brian Worsham mentioned, that just about every fire department in the United States is being forced to buy new equipment and go through very rigorous. Firemen can get killed in trying to rescue somebody from these vehicles because of the electric charge that's involved.
Right, not just the flames, but they can actually get electrocuted to death.
Yeah, it's an electrocution.
So that's worse than the Pinto.
Well, right. It's far worse than the Pinto because at least the Pinto was intelligent enough, number one, not to suck tax dollars out, but it only killed the driver. You know, this is going to kill first responders. Well, so and as part of that, they are going to recall the entire production line, which thankfully they haven't sold so many, so it won't be a terribly onerous thing. But what's interesting is how the liberal media, is reporting this. They're calling it a callback. Now, we all know the term recall. Recall right. has, you know, connotations. It's, there's a problem with the car. It's right. bad. It's not good. No, the mainstream media, ABC, CBS, NBC, CNN, are calling this a callback, not a recall. So, folks, the people who want you to think a certain way are out there working full time, big time.
Renaming reality.
Well, they're renaming reality, exactly. And it isn't a callback. It's a recall.
It's a recall.
Of a very dangerous and ridiculous
It's a world of advertising,
money.
Too. Advertising, mm-hmm. basically, they say, how do we get this point across and not hurt anybody? So.
Well, you know, I love your point because advertising, of course, comes from
right.
the company or the company that's trying to change your mind. But the term callback isn't part of their advertising.
Right.
Callback is coming from the mainstream media, who is actively on the advertising side
right.
of Government Motors and the Chevy Dolt. So, they're going to continue to spend money in this manner if they can get away with it. I would hope that they can't. I would just say, here's something that this actually happened last month in Muskegon County. But I found it interesting. And this is where your money just slips and slides away so easily. The county, through the Public Works Board, which is headed by a Republican, Marvin Engel, hired a law firm called Howard & Howard. And they were hired, quote, this is from the county website, because of their extensive expertise in the state of Michigan with wind turbine contracts, but not by low bid. Okay, so in other words, they didn't take the low bid for this expertise, but they paid more money because they got this really great law firm that really knows their stuff. They've got experience, and they're going to be way better, mo better, than the other legal firms that had bid on this.
Great advertising team.
Great.
Well, apparently the advertising team is whoever compiled the notes here. But here's how the county attends to this particular issue. This is great. H&H actually spent 520 hours during the course of drafting, negotiating, redrafting the lease, blah, blah, blah. Their original estimate was 250 hours. So what happened was we took the non-low bidder because of their expertise, but they were so expert that instead of their estimate of 250 hours, it was 529 hours for a total additional cost of $68,000. Now, this is county. Now, remember, this is an additional $68,000.
It's an extra that we get to pay for.
Exactly. Just 11-0 approved. You know, no big deal, folks. You know, next time let's make sure we pick the most expensive.
I don't understand putting it out to bids and not taking the low bid.
Neither do I, but Roger Miller does, and he's he's talking dang gum government. So we'll take a break and we'll be back shortly.
Don't you love me sometimes?
January 26th through the 29th, the Michigan International Auto Show returns to DeVos Place. You'll see vehicles from around the world on display right here in West Michigan. This year's show will feature some 300 new vehicles on display and factory representatives from nearly 40 different manufacturers. Don't miss the Million Dollar Motorway with the biggest display ever. You'll see a variety of high-end cars, including Bentley, Rolls-Royce, Aston Martin, Maserati, and Lamborghini. Tickets are just $10, $4 for kids and children 5 and under free. We'll see you at this year's auto show at DeVos Place.
Alka-Seltzer Plus presents The Cold Truth.
Ugh, I took some meds for this cold, but I'm still stuffed up.
Honey, what did you take?
NyQuil.
NyQuil doesn't unstuff your nose.
Huh?
There's no decongestant.
What?
Try Alka-Seltzer Plus Night Liquid Gels, a more complete cold formula that fights your worst cold symptoms, plus it relieves your stuffy nose.
That's The Cold Truth.
Alka-Seltzer Plus Night in a liquid gel.
Oh, what a relief it is.
And for fast relief of your worst allergy symptoms, try new Alka-Seltzer Plus Allergy.
Ugh, cold winter weather. It makes my skin so dry, itchy, and irritated. Can I get some help, please, for this winter skin of mine?
Cortisone 10 Intensive Healing has the strongest non-prescription itch medicine available. Its 7 moisturizers help heal skin, so you'll stop itching and start feeling relief fast.
Ah, my skin feels like it's been on vacation, even with 10 inches of snow outside.
Itch-free, worry-free, Cortisone 10. Use as directed.
I'm Kim Commando. It's my small business iPad giveaway sponsored by Carbonite, and it's going on right now. I'm giving away an iPad 2 every week for 12 weeks. Plus free one-year coverage from Carbonite.com. And if you're my grand prize winner, you'll also win a free one-on-one telephone business consultation with me, Kim Commando. So tune into my show right here this weekend and head over to Commando.com for more details. That's KOMANDO.com.
Catch the show Sundays at noon on News Talk 1090 WKBZ.
Well, you're dead. Gum government, you saw it so-and-so's. You got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes.
And we are back at Eye on Muskegon. We'd like to hear from you, too. We've got our phone number is still out there. It's 231-830-3109. You have an opportunity to be on the radio. You know, one thing I would just like to remind folks, to those of you who like the show, and would like other folks to know about it, of course, you can pass the word on. But we do post the full radio show, usually in Friday afternoon or Sunday afternoons, and that is on Eye on Muskegon, E-Y-E on Muskegon.com. And you can listen to the entire show. And then, Oscar, Mondays, you've done something with your business. Maybe you want to jump in on this.
Well, every Monday, of course, we have a rebroadcast of the show. It's usually 2 weeks past, but still, it's the show, and you can see Jim and his all his beauty and glory.
Oh, it doesn't get any better than that.
That's right. That's right. And his special hats and his special outfit that he wears every week too. So
you're talking about rebroadcasting it on television, correct?
On TV, yeah, on Channel 38, and it's also on Comcast 397. So it's 8 o'clock every Monday.
Well, and you've got a business. I mean, you video this here in the studio, and then you do many other things. But tell me a little bit more about the business you've got, because it's pretty, I think, very impressive.
Well, basically what it is I'm a videographer. I videotape just about anything. I'm more interested in documentaries and live programming and that kind of thing instead of most people like do the weddings and that kind of thing. I can do those, but I prefer doing shows like this or doing documentaries. I did some during the 150th anniversary at Whitehall. I covered all their events for the sesquicentennial and did all that stuff and put them all together on DVDs for people to watch. And a gentleman over there that was in big band and also had a Ford dealership in Whitehall, who was 97 years young, Rex Funnel, and also Dexter King, talked to them and, you know, did documentaries on them. And that seems to be pretty, because, you know, they were big in the community with Funnelfield and the big band era and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So, but just stuff like that. I really enjoyed that. I dug into the White River Light Station as far as did a documentary with that with Karen McDonald over there and talked about the light station and pretty much gave a tour of the light station for people that can't, you know, making right. up those spiraling staircases. And
oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, where are those available?
Yeah, that sounds like a real
those are all available at the Hokey Pokey, Colby's Hokey Pokey in Whitehall on Colby Street. So.
Okay.
Now, if they wanted to get in touch with you, how do they do that? You got a website and a telephone number, of course.
Website is oo-video.com and phone number 616-805-2862.
I think let's try to get that on the iamuskegan.com website too, just for folks who are interested in having a professional video your event. I know this, that this past week the Oceana Tea Party put on a tremendous event where they brought in five of the six candidates for the Republican nomination for the U.S. Senate to challenge Debbie Stabenow, and you came up and did you videoed the entire thing, and of course you were there early and chatted with folks, but. I'd love to see a view of that. Is that going to be posted any place?
It's going to be on YouTube. All you have to do is go to, when you go to YouTube, you can see all my stuff too. If you wanted to go to YouTube and then just in the search put Oscar Osbo, OSCAROSBO.
One word or two words?
One word.
One word. Okay.
And all my stuff is there, but the Tea Party will be all on there. My past Tea Party in Muskegon in 2010, I think it was.
Okay.
That's also on there and. Just a little bit of everything that I've done, so pieces of, you know.
Well, you know, you're a small businessman. You do things, of course. You are the legendary Oscar Osbo in the radio world, but you do lots of other things in with your small business. And I know you've done sports, football games, and that type of thing too.
Oh yeah, football. I love doing football and basketball. We got some basketball games running right now too. So, yeah, I was telling you too that it was kind of funny because actually the 25 years in radio, I think I was recognized more by doing Dial-A-Bargain on Muskegon Television.
Well,
we all have our niche.
And yeah, well, you know, what can I say?
Yeah, there we go. Well, hey, you know, it sure beats,
whatever.
Some of the things that we've seen on television, I can promise you. You know, Susie, you brought up something about that you noticed in your searching.
I did notice. I noticed two things that are big in our community, or maybe not so big in our community. One of them is the airport, which is continually losing money. And I noticed through the summer, instead of working to solve the problem of them losing money, the county put up big billboards that said, "Fly Muskegon, free parking through September." So it sounded to me like, park, you better fly now, or otherwise we're going to charge you to park. That did not seem like a way to solve the problem of the airport losing. And the bus terminal, our MAT system, although we have a wonderful MAT system, it continually loses money hand over fist. So now the solution is to build a brand new MAT terminal downtown and buy more buses. We've still not solved the problem. We just throw money at the problem. In both of those things.
Well, you're right. In the two cases with the airport and the MAT system, while they certainly add value to the county, but the left in particular, but certainly the people who spend our money love to use the term sustainability in the environmental sense.
Right.
But there's another very important definition for sustainability, and that's fiscal or financial sustainability. And the airport, my understanding, in addition to getting what the $600,000 a year check from the federal government to induce an airliner to come in here twice a day. But it also, the county pays somewhere in the neighborhood of it. It varies, but between $600,000 and $1 million a year. And the same goes for mats. These are expenditures that at some point may not be sustainable. And there doesn't, if you attend these meetings, the county commission meetings, the transportation committee meetings, you will see that from the 11 county commissioners, there seems to be no curiosity whatsoever, no interest in attending to these huge losses. They're solely interested in expanding and spending.
Expenditures for the...
And we are interested in going to break here right now. So we will be back after the break. And give us a call again, 231-830-3109.
Make 2012 the year you take control of your money. I'm bringing our Total Money Makeover live back to Grand Rapids on May 5th. At this event, I'll teach you how to beat debt for good. Seats are just $29. Get them now at DaveRamsey.com.
I'm sure you're thinking, boy, I'd like to pay less for my car insurance, but switching seems like a lot of work. All the hassle and whatnot. Well, I'm here to tell you that is simply not the case. GEICO makes it so easy to switch and start saving money straight away without getting buried in a ton of paperwork. You know, that actually happened to me once. Literally, I was buried under my income taxes for 6 days. Haunting, really.
For a free rate quote, visit GEICO.com. GEICO, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
You can stop a cold with Coldies. Coldies' unique formula releases zinc ions that are absorbed in your upper respiratory system and stop the cold virus's ability to reproduce.
Hi, I'm Ted Karkus, CEO. Symptom relievers can provide temporary relief, but Coldies can actually shorten your cold. It's number one pharmacist recommended, and I guarantee it.
Stop the cold, not just the symptoms. Find Coldies in the cough cold section or at Coldies.com.
Claims based on Cleveland Clinic study which demonstrated that Coldies shortened the average duration of the common cold by nearly half.
At Advance Auto Parts, we don't do anything just part way. We go full throttle. We don't just sell batteries, no. We install them fast and free with purchase on most vehicles. We install rain or shine or even that weird thing where there are some clouds, the sun is shining, but you're still getting rained on? Yeah, we'll still install it. Free battery installation, even in weird weather. Only at Advance Auto Parts. Service is our best part. Advance Auto Parts. See store for details.
Factory Surplus Sales in Montague has a huge selection of winter apparel. Hats, jackets, mittens, boots, and more. Everything your family needs to keep warm. All at huge savings. Factory Surplus also has everything you hunters need to stay warm in the woods.
The talk of Muskegon is News Talk 1090, WKBC Muskegon. And heard 24 hours a day on WOOD HD2 Muskegon.
Fox News Radio. I'm Chris Foster. The Republican presidential candidates got just a few hours to go over their performances, get some sleep, and go at it again, debating in Concord, New Hampshire this morning after last night's ABC News debate in Manchester. Usual topics, the economy, foreign policy, and social issues like gay marriage, which Mitt Romney opposes.
There's every right for people in this country to form long-term committed relationships with one another. That doesn't mean that they have to call it marriage or they have to receive the approval of the state and a marriage license and so forth for that to occur.
Newt Gingrich says Christians get a hard time for opposing gay marriage.
The bigotry question goes both ways, and there's a lot more anti-Christian bigotry today than there is concern on the other side, and none of it gets covered by the news media.
Romney leading the polls with the New Hampshire primary on Tuesday. An Iranian senior commander says they will shut down the Strait of Hormuz, that's a key oil shipping route, if its exports are blocked by other nations over Iran's nuclear program. That quote given to an Iranian newspaper today. It's a year ago since Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords and 18 other people were shot in Tucson, Arizona. Fox News Radio's Chris Stanley.
Applause for the congresswoman recovering from the headshot she took in the massacre as she enters the Safeway store in front of which the shooting took place. Also in the city, a series of outdoor events under the umbrella title Beyond to commemorate those killed that day, who included Gifford staffer Gabe Zimmerman. Ross Zimmerman is his father.
This should be a day for everybody who's lost someone to celebrate their life and celebrate the joys.
The events including tree plantings at a children's peace garden established after the shooting.
And there's a candlelight vigil in Tucson tonight. At the Vatican, Pope Benedict baptizing 16 babies in the Sistine Chapel, an annual ceremony marking the end of the Catholic Christmas season and the baptism of Jesus Christ. You're listening to Fox News Radio. Fair and balanced.
Neon, day glow, flashing lights, special effects. Today's world puts our sense of sight on overload. Luckily, there are places we can go to refocus our senses. Our national wildlife refuges. It's a wonder how much you'll see once all the distractions fade away. You may see a lone eagle soaring past massive snow-capped mountains, or a great horned owl perched stoically on a branch nearby. You may see the furry face of a baby sea otter curiously poking its head out of the dark blue sea, or ancient rocks shaped by centuries of wind. When you see these things, you're seeing the world the way we found it. With over 500 refuges across America, you don't have to go far to make a special connection with nature. Learn more at fws.gov/refuges. That's fws.gov/refuges.
News Talk 1090 is the talk of Muskegon.
Well, you dadgum government, you sorry so-and-sos. You got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes. Well, you dadgum.
And we are back at Eye on Muskegon. Muskegon County and West Michigan's number one rated political talk radio show. And we have a special guest on the phone right now, Senator Jeff Hansen, West Michigan's number one rated Republican senator. I would say any kind of senator is on the phone with us. Good morning, Senator.
Good morning, Jim. How are you this morning?
We are wonderful. And I'm here with Susie Hughes.
Good morning, Susie.
Good morning, Senator.
And, of course, Oscar Osmo. You know, one thing before we get into the senator, the opening music, which, of course, is the dag-gum government. We are not against government. We just want government to listen to us and to respond to us. And author and the singer of that particular music is the very prolific and famous and sadly no longer with us, Roger Miller. But Roger would have just had a birthday, Oscar,
What would you say, January 2nd?
January 2nd, I believe it was. Mm-hmm. So a belated happy birthday to the gentleman who's providing us with our wonderful
intro
opening
outro.
Song.
Yeah,
yes. So anyway, Senator, again, thank you for being with us. And a couple of issues, you folks, I think, in particular the Republicans, but I think the Republicans and Democrats under our new governor, Governor Snyder, have done a wonderful job so far in 2011 and looking forward to 2012 in accomplishing things that will make our state a better state for businesses and for jobs and ultimately for all of the citizens in the state. And I got an email, which I'm sure that you've seen, but this came from the governor's office, and this was a blast email sent out to everybody. But it was titled "The Most Underreported Story of 2011. And it really struck me because it is so true. And I'll just read a little bit from it. It says, take, for example, the action the administration recently took to deal with Michigan's unfunded liabilities problem. Now, this is a problem that we face here in Muskegon County. Unfunded liabilities are promises to pay without any money to do it. And the efforts of you in particular, but your Republican cohorts and some of the Democrats in Lansing, saved Michigan taxpayers $5.6 billion just in this past year. And I think that is a tremendous accomplishment, and I thank you for it. And maybe you want to just extrapolate a little bit about that.
Well, it's been a big part of what we're trying to do is we're trying to get back to be responsible with the money that people entrust us with. First of all, is we owe quite a bit of money. About, oh gosh, I'm thinking it's in the $60 billion range in our long-term cost. It might be more than that. Some of the things that we're doing, looking at our long-term liabilities, are one of the things we just did was the unemployment fund that we owe the federal government. We owe them about $3.2 billion because Michigan's been kind of in a little deeper recession than other states. So what we've done is we've passed legislation that we're going to bond for that $3.2 billion because this year what happens is we have to start paying the federal government interest and penalties on the $3.2 billion that we owe.
Now, that's money that the state of Michigan had to borrow from the federal government in order to pay unemployment benefits to folks. In other words, money we didn't have.
Right.
And you're gonna do what now?
Well, we're going to bond and we're going to pay off the federal government because we don't feel that our employers should be paying penalties and interest for the money that was have to borrow because of the recession that we've had.
So can you, now this is interesting, I had not heard this before. The federal government charges penalties that have to be passed on to employers, but in doing this bonding, those penalties and interest will disappear for the employers?
Well, the interest will still be there because the employers have to pay this. This is all paid by employers.
Okay.
So they will have to pay all of it back. But at the federal government level, the interest was higher, plus there was the penalties that went along with it. So what we're going to do is we're going to bond so that we do not owe the federal government on this. And we think we're going to bond for just a little bit more, so we have a little bit of a cushion, so that as we go through this, we're going to have this cushion that we're not going to have to go right back and borrow from the federal government again and get back into this pickle.
Okay, now this sounds to me much like the common sense alternatives and the common sense ideas that the governor had said that he would enact when he, if he were elected, and certainly has done. This seems kind of, no-brainer to me, and it also seems odd to me that, you know, the governor hasn't even been governor for a full year, and that you guys have done the list of accomplishments. I hate to be fawning here, but I think the list of accomplishments has been substantial. And it's stunning that it didn't get done in the years in the past. So I applaud you for this. I know that if you reduce the cost of doing business to employers, you ultimately will have more employees, and that's truly what we're looking for.
Well, there has to be some way for the businesses to recoup their dollars so that they can hire more people.
Well,
things are doing better in our area. I look at the different manufacturers, I look at the different businesses, and talking to them, it's Muskegon's doing pretty well right now. We're actually below the state average for unemployment.
Well, one thing I've also read is that Michigan is the number two, the fastest growing economic recovery in the nation, and with the unemployment in the state below 10% for the first time in more than 3 years. You know, some things that the government does can make an instant change. And I just, I don't want to give you too many pats on the back, but I think that you guys have really jumped into it and done a great job there. Now, a couple of other tougher questions, perhaps.
Okay.
A quick one, I hope. You voted against the bridge to Canada, and you weren't alone, of course. This was voted down fairly heavily. Not so much on whether that's a good idea or a bad idea, but where does that issue stand today? Because there's been a lot of talk about it.
Well, it's not dead. The governor is still talking about it. And eventually, you know, we probably need to have another structure there. And the governor is still pushing for it, and he's got some ideas on how he wants to go through it. And I'm still waiting to see exactly what his ideas are as we move forward.
Okay, so 2012, it'll continue to mosey along. It's not a done issue.
Nope, it's not done. It's still in committee.
Okay, all right. Here's another one that the governor, at least last I read, has said that he's not necessarily for, but would sign if it came across his desk. But it's heated up, and it's becoming a big issue now in Indiana, which, of course, is right-to-work legislation. Again, not so much to argue the right or wrong of it, but where does that stand in the state of Michigan in terms of the legislature and timing?
Well, it just keeps moving along. I'm a little concerned about the timing of it at this time because we, to keep Michigan going forward, we need all hands on deck. That's a pretty divisive issue as you, you know, as it comes forward. There's people that are talking about it. There's several people that are talking about it. And I guess we have to discuss it with leadership and find out exactly where it's at. But it just keeps moving along.
Well, is it something, you know, as you said, and I'll say just my own opinion, we've got a very important election coming up. From the Republican standpoint, a very massively divisive issue like right to work might tend to bring out more and more Democrats than Republicans. So it would seem to me that it would make sense that this issue would be best discussed and made important or made front page stuff after the election. I'm not asking you as to the whys or wherefores, but it would seem that both sides don't want this to go. Is my assumption that we're not likely to see a whole lot of real talk here in Michigan until after the election in November?
I would probably agree with that.
Okay. All right. I'll throw you a softball every once in a while.
Yeah, that one.
One other one, and this was brought up. You may have been here at the time on the Talkin' Muskegon show with John Van Wyk and Brian Worsham, but one of the gentlemen, Dean, who shows up occasionally, had asked a very good question. There's a discussion going on right now about, not a discussion, an announcement that the Cobb plant is going to close in about 3 years in good measure because of federal regulations. That could be a disaster for Muskegon County in terms of property taxes lost. And, of course, jobs lost and many other things. The Cobb plant and Consumers Power has been huge in terms of supporting events in Muskegon County. Is that a done deal? Is there anything? I know this is a federal issue, but you are our representative here.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a done deal? Is there anything going on with that? Because certainly many of us would like to see that plant to continue on.
Well, I don't know that it's a done deal yet. We're still having discussions, but it is a big chunk of Muskegon's revenue. We do have a lot of people working there that are good-paying jobs that we don't want to see lost in our area.
Well over 100.
Yeah, so we have to be vigilant to talk to them about it.
Well, so, is the Senate, is the state Senate and the state House? And the governor, do you guys have a voice here in this? Can you be stopping into Debbie Stabenow's office and saying, hey, we need some help on this, or in Senator Levin's office?
We can, we can send letters, make phone calls on it.
Okay.
As we do it. But it is a private industry's business on what they're going to do.
Okay, but they're responding though to the federal government's
right.
regulations.
Well, I mean,
they don't. It's not their choice. They're being forced into this issue.
We can make calls and send letters. Is pretty much it, unless you want to go to Washington.
Now, Senator
okay.
Hanson, haven't you in the state relaxed some of the environmental standards to increase businesses in our area? Does that not help the Cobb plant at all?
I'm sorry, with what?
With the environmental situation. I know that the state has reduced some of those restrictions.
Yeah, what they're working on right now is the federal restrictions that are coming online or came online the first of the year. Or it may be the first of next year.
Okay. I wondered if those were federal or state regulations.
Yeah, those are federal.
Okay.
Okay, so all you can do and all we can do here then is to make some noise, which is I think very important, and get in touch with the two Democrat senators from our state, federal senators, which would be Debbie Stabenow, who was up for election come November, and Senator Levin,
right,
and of course Congressman Huizenga. let him know that that we support keeping this plant open. And I think there's many other reasons for it. But a couple of other things that I'd like to get to, if I could. You have been involved in something that I think is really important. And, you know, we Tea Party folks, we conservatives, are not anti-government. We just are concerned about responsive government. And you have one of the issues that you have made important to you is expanding the Healthy Kids Dental Program in Muskegon, Oceana, Mason, and Newaygo counties. And as someone who's I know of some people who just don't have the money for dental care. Of course, it's not Medicaid or Medicare generally kind of thing. And especially young people who have these horrible, painful dental experiences. I think this is a very good program. Could you maybe expand a little bit on that?
Well, dental care is so important to our children because it affects their entire health. And so what we've had is these are actually Medicaid folks.
Oh, this is Medicaid. Okay.
This is Medicaid. Right. It's Medicaid, but what we're doing is we're contracting with Delta Dental. And so by doing that, all of the dentists that take Delta insurance will also be taking the Medicaid people. It's over 40,000 kids in my four counties.
Okay.
So what happens is they have a lot more dentists that they can go to because there's a lot of dentists won't take Medicaid because it doesn't pay the amount to even, you know, even their cost. With the Delta Dental, they're getting up into the Delta reimbursements. So it's very helpful. It allows the dentist to be able to at least recoup their money and help these kids out. Because what happens in Muskegon is we went from like 9 providers to 4 pages of providers.
Okay, that is huge. I've been recently. I had a little skin lesion, and I went into the doctor's office, and they had a big sign up there: "We do not accept Medicare or Medicaid." So it is important that especially in this case, this is a dental issue. That it's one thing to say you've got dental insurance; it's another thing to be able to actually get it. You know, I really like this program, and I didn't know about it until I did a little show prep before talking with you today. But this is one of the things that quality, responsible, intelligent governance can bring to the community. If you're broke, you can't do these kinds of things that are so important to people at any age, and in this case, it's young people. If you're broke, you just don't have the money to do it. What you folks have done in this past year in what I would call common sense decisions, you know, one in particular, which is requiring everybody to pay their fair share in state income taxes, which includes those very folks who get the state support, which is the state employees and county employees and teachers and the rest of them who previously didn't pay any state mm-hmm. income tax on their pensions. I think common sense things like this result in the ability, number one, to pay down the debt, which is what you're doing, which ultimately results in lower costs for businesses, which will ultimately result in more employees and employers. And I think programs like this Kids Dental is wonderful, and I applaud you and your group of Republicans, and I would hope Democrats join you in this, but certainly the governor, who I wasn't a real super fan of to begin with, has made me feel quite good about the future of this state.
Well, there is some common sense because we are paying down more than just the unemployment and things like that. We've got a lot of the other trying to pre-fund some of our liabilities that we have rather than pay-as-you-go type thing with the retirements and things like that. We're putting some money in so that, you know, for every, it's an astronomical amount, but for every 500,000, I'm paraphrasing this because I'd have to go back and find the numbers. It seems like it's like $1 billion you can save by pre-funding it rather than letting it just go down the road. And we've been able to do that. This year we've also put some money in the rainy day fund so that we've actually got a fund so that we can balance these big up and downs rather than have some of the problems we've had in the last few years where, because there was more want than there was dollars, that the government actually shut down a couple times.
Yeah, and again, responsible, intelligent, creative governance results in the ability to do what we all do at home with our own personal finances, which is pay our bills and save for the future.
That's
as
right.
Opposed to, frankly, getting to where we were a year ago.
Well, you probably noticed this year that we passed the budget early.
I noticed that.
And
that was historic, really.
Yeah, well, it was important because you have to put it out there so people know what it's going to be. You have to give them time to be able to work with it, because if they know what they've got, they can deal with it. As we put it out there, I mean, part of the problem was is before we were waiting till December 30th, sometimes October 1st to pass a budget. Well, you go back to our schools, and they have to have their budget done by July 1st. So they're going by, well, we think you're going to have this. And then at the end of the day, did they get that? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. So it was important that we got it done so everybody knew where we were going to start. This is the year that it pretty much reset everything, and now we're going to go forward. We've got had our the dollars coming in have started going up a little bit. People are getting back to work. We've got things happening. You know, it's a good thing with our big three, the auto companies, have been starting to sell some cars because the ripple effect on that is huge. It's absolutely huge. We have all of our people in Muskegon that are going back to work. We got people all over Michigan that are going back to work partially with that. But there's also the ripple effect with the things that these people going back to work are going to be able to afford again. So there's other jobs created. So it's been a big deal. Sorry. But Muskegon is kind of in the forefront of this. And, you talked about Michigan being the number two for growth. West Michigan is actually number one in the nation. I heard this just the other day for things coming back and happening.
That's, if you think about what an incredible concept if somebody two or three or even 1 year ago would have even suggested that. It would have it would have sounded like a very bad, unfunny Saturday Night Live skit. And here, in fact, it's come to pass.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is a tough question, and it's okay if you don't have the answer. But it just seems to me that in 1 year, you guys and women have accomplished so many things and have righted the ship that truly was just about ready to sink. Is what comes next? We've got now 2012 here. Are there going to be significant changes? What anything exciting coming down the pike for 2012?
Well, there's a lot of things. The governor did his infrastructure, his transportation special message. We are going to be talking about transportation. Our roads need to be fixed. We are not keeping up with keeping our roads up. So that is definitely something that we have to talk about. Another thing that we've been talking about is the personal property tax, but you probably noticed it hasn't got done yet because it's not just an easy take-it-away thing, because the dollars that come in from personal property tax are huge for our local governments. So it's not something you can just do away with. You have to find a way to offset it. You have to find a way to replace it.
Is that something that's in your view, will be fixed and voted on and passed in 2012?
Well, it could be. When it came out last year, I thought it would be talked and fixed in 2011. But it's more complicated than anybody, as they started digging into it, understood. And we definitely want to find a way to fix it's a terrible tax, because what it does is when somebody buys equipment, they have to make payments to the government pretty much forever on that equipment as a tax, because they've improved their equipment, bought new or brought in used or whatever they've done. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to make it so that that isn't the way it is. You know, that they don't have to pay on that, because it just stops people from buying more equipment, expanding and making their business grow and be better.
Okay, I think few, if anyone, would disagree with you on what you just said there. But the question, of course, then remains the replacing of that revenue lost to the various governments.
Right.
What ideas have been floated? Again, you don't need to take a position, but there have been different ideas out there, I'm sure, that have been floated by that would help replace that revenue. Can you give us maybe a short list of what has been talked about and what might have a possibility of coming to pass?
Well, they had talked about one of the things is just kind of phasing it out, that any new equipment in the future that has been bought won't pay it. Another one is looking at using the tax credits that are expiring. We have a lot of businesses that have had tax credits through the years through Renaissance zones, agriculture Renaissance zones, and all these different things that have, and they're phased, those are being coming to the end of their life and being phased out. And there's, I think they're figuring $500 million there that could be used to offset that. None of it has fit exactly right yet.
Okay. Well, it's being discussed. And I know that one of the items that you count as a plus, and I don't, but this is the extension of the Renaissance Zones agreements here in Muskegon County. And you and Representative Holly Hughes were involved in that, and I'm not totally against it, but you've brought home some bacon to Muskegon and helping that continue on. How long is that something that might be cut with these, you know, as a possibility? And also, how long since we've decided or there's been an extension of these Renaissance Zones for downtown Muskegon?
How long is that? Hold on a minute, Jim. This isn't an extension of a Renaissance Zone. This is allowing them to continue with a contract they signed to the end of the contract.
Oh, now that's a critical difference.
It doesn't include any new.
There's no. This isn't an extension. This
did not know that.
Any new time. This is just that we've got developers that put their money into developments thinking that they were going to play by these rules all the way through. And, well, they got partway in, and they have several hundred thousand dollars invested, and the rules change, and they can't use those credits anymore.
That's a huge difference, and I thank you for correcting me. I did not know that.
And so that was...
That's huge.
That was the part that bothered me, is this is something that they had counted on, talking about John Rook's property, was a High Point Flats or something there in town, is he had people that were committing to buying, but with the Renaissance zone part of it going away, he was afraid that all these 20 people that he had signed up we're going to just say, nope, sorry, the rules have changed. We're not going to be able to get the credits that we were supposed to get.
Okay, well, I'm going to give you and Representative Hughes credit for the continuation of these, and I will quit my grumpiness about them.
Because that is a good thing. It really is.
I think it's critical. One of the problems that I think all of us who are interested in politics have is that we rely on our own research to get the information. We don't always have an opportunity to talk with someone like yourself, and I would just say thank you for clarifying that.
Mm-hmm.
The final thing, we are coming up to a break here, but you've got some upcoming neighborhood association meetings and things of that sort. Do you have those handy to tell us when you're going to be in town again?
Well, actually, the mayor, Steve Warmington, is putting together these meetings around town because they've got a kind of a task force on trying to make sure Muskegon is safe. And kudos to him for going out and all the people that have put this together to make this work. I'm going to try and get to a couple of the meetings to just kind of be there.
Okay.
See if there's anything I can, any help I can lend.
Okay.
It's more so their thing. It's just something I'm going to try and touch base with them on.
Okay. Good. Well, then we'll try to post on iamuskegon.com those meetings. We'll talk about it here when we get specifics. And we will, it's a Sunday morning. Sounds like you got a little bit of a cold there, Senator.
I've been fighting it for a few days.
All right. Well, we very much appreciate you being on this morning. We very much appreciate what you're doing out there. We'll keep an eye on you, Senator Hansen. But thanks again. And you have a great Sunday and a great next week.
Well, thanks. And you too. And it's great to hear you. And Susie, it's good to hear from you.
Good to hear from you too, Senator.
And you guys, keep up the good work. Keep the message going out.
We'll do it. Thanks so much, sir.
All right.
And we will be back in just a few.
Oh, don't you love me sometimes?
January 26th through the 29th, the Michigan International Auto Show returns to DeVos Place. You'll see vehicles from around the world on display right here in West Michigan.
Factory Surplus Sales in Montague has a huge selection of winter apparel. Hats, jackets, mittens, boots, and more. Everything your family needs to keep warm. All at huge savings. Factory Surplus also has everything you hunters need to stay warm in the woods.
This is Mike McCready, Pearl Jam's lead guitarist. Join me and help transform the lives of the 1.4 million Americans living with Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Sign up today for one of the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation's Take Steps Walks at cctakesteps.org.
Sirens, jet engines, car horns, leaf blowers. Today's world puts our sense of hearing on overload. Luckily, there are places we can go to refocus our senses. Our national wildlife refuges. It's amazing how much more you'll hear when you just take a minute to listen. Like a stirring chorus of songbirds warbling in the treetops. Or the industrious beaver slapping its tail in the mountain pond over baritone bullfrogs. Or the pulsating beat of a pileated woodpecker looking for a meal. When you hear these things, you're hearing the world the way we found it. With over 500 refuges across America, you don't have to go far to make a special connection with nature. Learn more at fws.gov/refuges. That's fws.gov/refuges.
Hi, my name's Bob.
Hi, Bob.
So I see this ad on TV. It says I can reduce my debt by 50%. So I call. They told me to stop paying my bills, stop talking to my creditors. It didn't seem right. But they said they'd take care of everything.
I gave them thousands of dollars, but most of it went to their fees.
Getting out of debt is neither quick nor easy. There are those who will tell you anything just to win your trust.
Sounded perfect. I did everything they told me to do.
They never paid my creditors. They didn't even contact them.
Turns out I'm even more in debt because the fees and the interest on my cards kept piling up.
Bad advice from so-called experts can make your financial situation worse.
And the bank turned me down for a mortgage. And that's when I realized my credit was shot. I should have gone straight to my creditors to begin with.
There is a better way to get help. Talk to your creditors directly, or to find a nonprofit agency near you, visit debtadvice.org. Debtadvice.org. Real solutions for real people. This has been a public service message.
Fox News Radio, I'm Liz White. A debate the morning after the last one for GOP presidential candidates in New Hampshire. Last night on ABC, frontrunner Mitt Romney talked up his experience in the private sector.
Let's not forget, this is a free enterprise system. We don't need government to come in and tell us how to make businesses work. We need people with passion, willing to take risk and help turn things around.
This morning's debate is now underway. It's been a year since the deadly shootings in Tucson, Arizona that severely wounded Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords. Her husband, Mark Kelly, says she isn't sure about her political future just yet.
She thinks about it often. We talk about it. And, you know, she's hopeful that she'll get to a point where she can make a decision to run for re-election and to stay in office.
Giffords plans to appear at a candlelight vigil this evening with other survivors marking the anniversary with reflection. Fox News. We report. You decide.
Here's the official News Talk 1090 WKBZ forecast. Today we'll see sunshine and clouds together with a high around 40. Southwest winds 10 to 20. Partly cloudy skies tonight, a low of 34 with west winds 10 to 15. Tomorrow, partly to mostly cloudy and windy with the southwest winds running 20 to 30 miles an hour and still mild with a high of 43. And then for Tuesday, mostly cloudy with a high of 44. Wednesday brings sunshine and a high of 43. News Talk 1090 WKBZ, the top. Of Muskegon.
Hi, everybody. This is Gary Sullivan. Well, it's a brand new year. I hope you can join us this weekend on the radio as we discuss all the things that may have went wrong in your home during the holidays. Hopefully, we'll have fixes for those. And then we'll also discuss the new projects that you might have for 2012. Hope you can join me this weekend. Your call's always important. See you this weekend.
Catch the show Sunday afternoons at 6 on News Talk 1090 WKBZ, the talk of Muskegon.
So-and-so's, you got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes. Where you
at? And we are back at Eye on Muskegon. Just a couple of housekeeping issues. Muskegon County Board of Commissioners is back working. They met twice last week, and they will be meeting twice this week. And as always, I will be at Carmen's Cafe in downtown Muskegon. It's on the corner of Clay and Terrace. And I'll be there Tuesday and Thursday from 2 to 3:15. You're welcome to join me. Just when you step in there, if you don't know who I am, just ask, hey, where's the radio guy? I leave around 3:15. Leave Carmen's, and I go across a couple streets over to the county building, fourth floor of the county building, and I sit in and I take notes and video the county commission meetings, and you are welcome to join me there also. The reason I go to Carmen's is to talk with people about local government, state and a county and cities and township and school boards, and you are certainly welcome to join me at any time. If you'd like to call and get in touch with me prior to or any other time, you're welcome to. My phone number is 231-830-3109. And you can email me at ionmuskegon@gmail.com. And, of course, you can go to the blog, the Ion Muskegon blog, ionmuskegon.com. So I'd love to talk with you. And, you know, one of the things that we were talking about on the break is county transparency. We have a new year. It's 2012. You kind of like to think that the bad old habits will be rubbed away. But in the first two meetings of 2012, I think the county commission took some serious steps in the wrong direction in terms of transparency and being open with the public. But Susie, you had some other thoughts about this transparency issue.
I did. You know, one of the things that cost Muskegon County an enormous amount of money is adding new employees. In the past, we had a policy that no hires were made without going to the County Board of Commissioners and asking for their approval and showing how that employee was needed. It cost the taxpayers $445,000 a year to have that Board of Commissioners. And instead of doing what I consider their job of deciding whether we needed new employees, they passed that on to the county administrator. So nowhere, in no shape or form, do we know, or even the county commissioners know, when somebody new is hired. And just for an example, when you had to go before the county commissioners, usually there was one or maybe two that came before the county board every month. Right now on the county website, on external job opportunities, there's 10 openings just this month. 10 openings. And those are things that before you had to show the need for that job and explain where it was going to be paid for. Now all of that just flies under the radar, and the county commissioners at $400,000 a year for the 11 of them don't even have any authority over that at all. And the hiring just continues.
Well, it's not that they don't have the authority, because they have complete and total authority over that. They just chose not to exercise their authority. And I can appreciate that the county commissioners and the rest of us in the county, we don't want them to micromanage. We don't want them to be looking at every single little event that happens in the county. But we do want them, certainly on things that are important and big expenditures like employees,
right.
We do want want them to at least be made aware of. And what I've found as I've been attending these county commission meetings is there seems to be a frightening fundamental base lack of curiosity about what's going on. Now, I have no problem if you know of someone who's looks to be living a wonderful life. They're paying their bills. They're a good mom and dad, and their kids are fine and everything else. You don't really have any interest in sticking your nose in their business. But our county is $100 million underfunded in its employee retiree health and benefit plans and pension plans. And let me make this clear. We don't owe $100 million for the retiree pension and health care benefits. We owe probably a half a billion. We're $100 million underfunded. In other words, a certain portion of it is funded correctly. It's not just that we owe this $100 million. This is we need $100 million in order to get back to zero in terms of being on plan to effectively finish up and our promise to these retired employees.
And did you notice that Senator Hansen said that the state has started pre-funding? So it's not that the taxpayer money can't be used appropriately and pre-fund. It's just that the county chooses not only not to pre-fund, but to just keep building the debt.
And what's the benefit? I mean, you know, here we have the state with good, strong support from Democrats. The state is enacted any number of new laws and new policies that have are helping us get out of this debt, and they're stopping the further expenditures that have caused the problems. Here in Muskegon County, and we're going to get into this a little later on in other shows, but here in Muskegon County, we are continuing the policies that have gotten us into trouble. And I think, you know, you mentioned something about employees. This one really bothered me because it's not so much the employee position here, but it's the concept. And I'll just read to you what they call an item for consideration. This is from the Human Resources Department requesting this. It says, the Human Resources Department recently had a retirement, and the position was funded by the Workers' Compensation Fund. And I do not know what that is. In an attempt to reduce cost to this program, this is a request for the authorization to reclassify department clerk position, blah, 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 to a typist, which will result in an approximate total savings of $16,000. Now, that's good. That's a good deal. The current position is funded 100% in the Workers' Compensation Fund. The new typist will be funded 50% from the Workers' Compensation Fund and 50% from the Operations Insurance Fund to assist with the increased employee benefits workload. Now, I can assure you that there's not a single county commissioner who did take the time to read that particular, two sentences, that they really understood what was going on. And for all I know, it's a wonderful idea, or maybe it's an awful idea. But there are two points here. Number one, we pay these commissioners, we compensate them. I think royally, they're paid between their total compensation. It costs us the taxpayer between $40,000 and $45,000 per commissioner per year. That includes pension, that includes health, lifetime health benefits, and other perks. So they have the responsibility, but we're also paying them to do the job. And they're looking at issues. This is a little issue, but this happens multiple times a month. It's very unclear as to what's happening. But here's the real deal. It looks to me, if I'm reading this correctly, it looks to me that they are actually adding an additional employee. But it doesn't matter because it's being paid by something called the Workers' Compensation Fund. At some point, this mythical mystery Workers' Compensation Fund may not be paying for this additional employee. So the $16,000 that they're showing as being a savings right off the get-go may not be the case. In other words, there's no follow-up. You know, is this going to be funded in perpetuity, which I think I can safely say no. At some point, this funding is going to disappear. They're not going to know about it. So, in other words, we're seeing this, I call it a three-card Monty, where they're showing a big savings, but the reality is far too often that the savings is relatively short-term. And nobody bothers to ask the question. Number one, explain it to me. And number two, What is our plan? What's our procedure? What's our policy to follow up?
You know, I don't think there is a plan because this is
right.
This is an isolated incident for this particular one. But at every single board meeting, they hire somebody or approve hiring somebody with no effect on general fund. Well, when those funds die up, I never see them come back and say, this program doesn't exist anymore, or there is no more funding for that. What do we do with this employee, or what do we do with this program?
Yes.
Do they just get absorbed in, and we just keep paying and paying and paying, and now it goes back to the general fund, and it's an expense there? I'd like to know, because I've never got an answer to that question.
Well, let me explain what you mean by the general fund. The general fund is essentially the county has a discretionary budget of around $42, $43 million a year. That's what they call the general fund. But what they don't tell you is that when you hire an employee, let's just say you pay $50,000 a year for a particular employee, that $50,000 will affect the general fund, unless there's some other money coming in, which is what I'm concerned about, and I think what you're mentioning, mm-hmm. too, that money might be coming in for 6 months or a year. When that money stops, the job doesn't stop. So it most certainly does have an effect on the general fund. But there's an even more insidious part of this, and that is when you hire somebody and you pay them $50,000, for instance, in all likelihood, you are paying them $20,000 or more a year, or at least you're indebting the county to $20,000 a year in their pension and their retiree benefits. And that doesn't count as being part of the general fund. That just goes back into this $100 million that we are continually in the hole in.
That's never listed either.
When
they approve something, they'll tell you the salary. But the salary alone is really just the tip of the iceberg, and it's the salary a lot of times that doesn't have an effect on general fund. They don't tell you what the rest of it is,
exactly.
And that does have an effect.
And you know, when someone tells you the half-truth, and the term for that is called sophistry, they tell you the half-truth, they know the full truth. In other words, they say, this person only costs us $50,000, when in fact they know it's $70,000 is what it really costs. Then you have to start wondering, if they're not going to be upfront with us on simple things like this, easy things that we can find out if we're interested in digging, if they're not going to be fully truthful with us, what are the other things that are going on?
Oh,
and again, it is unbelievable. And we rely on these 11 elected county commissioners to ask those questions. You know, we have lives. We have to, you know, go to work, take care of our family, do any number of things, put together things for a radio show once a week.
Right.
And we rely on these elected representatives to look into these types of things. And I would allege that it doesn't appear to me that we are getting our money's worth. And this is countywide. I know that some of the cities and some of the townships, their elected officials have an entirely different view, where they believe that they are representing the people, and they do ask very tough questions, and of course in some cases they don't. But I'll give you an example. Next week we're going to have County Commissioner Alan Jagger and perhaps someone else come in and talk about some of these things. But Commissioner Jagger, at the organizational meeting, or I believe one of the two meetings this past week, specifically got up and he read a statement, and he said, he said that we don't have enough time as county commissioners to review the items that we have to vote on, and we don't have enough time to take the information back to our constituents and find out how they want us to vote.
He even said that on the show, too. He said that, too.
Yes, he said it before. Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, it's become an issue with him. And as he is well aware, and as I have mentioned, the official notice to the county commissioners is 3 days. But as a matter of practice, many of the most important votes, in particular those that are involving the union and employee costs, which account for about 80% of the entire county budget, many of those decisions have even less than the 3 days. Some cases, county commissioners would walk in a building and find there's something new on the agenda. So,
you know, sometimes it's just a matter of minutes, because it's not uncommon for them to hold a committee meeting directly before the county commission meeting, and something that was discussed at that committee meeting now comes before the full board just within minutes. There's not even time to open your laptop and log on to find out any answers at all.
Absolutely. Yeah, and that's an excellent point, and that's happening more and more. Well, so what you had here was a county commissioner, an elected county commissioner, gets up and says, you know, we need more time. We need time to communicate with our constituents. We need time to understand. We need time to do our research, to do what we're paid to do.
To do the job.
And he was saying that he'd like to have 7 days, which, frankly, is not an outrage to me.
I don't think so either.
Well, his comment says, I don't believe I'm given enough time to ask my constituents, you know, what I'm up to.
It's funny that nobody else agreed with that.
Well, actually, one person did.
Oh, did they?
Commissioner Rolstein Wilkins, she seconded his amendment. This is to the rules. And you can just see, and I've got the video of this. It's up. I posted it. It's on ionmuskegon.com. Matter of fact, that's one of my New Year's resolutions, is to post every county commission meeting on the website so that you can see them. And I think you'll be shocked at how many of these meetings are 15 minutes or less. Certainly most are half an hour or less.
Spending millions of dollars.
They're spending millions of dollars, and of course they're receiving less than $500,000.
I'm sure Muskegon TV would be interested in having those to put on Muskegon television also.
Well, they're available, and most certainly if we can get some publicity as to how our folks are representing us. But the first comment, and you could just see, my video is not like Oscars, you could just see the oh, gosh, you know, this guy, you know, why is he asking this? We're too busy for this. And one of the comments, this is from Commissioner Marv Engel, you know, says, things are happening too fast in some cases to wait the 7 days. Think about that. If something is so important that there's not enough time for two county commissioners who said, we don't have enough time. They've said, we don't have enough time. And you get somebody up there who says, no, things are happening too fast for you to accurately and effectively and intelligently review and make those decisions. That's where we are. That's what they did in the first week of 2012. I say it's without any question, it's wrong. I would also say that when they took the vote, now, the interesting thing here, they took the vote. I know that Commissioner Snyder also felt that the 3 days was more than enough to review and ask questions and communicate with your constituents. But Commissioner Snyder moved to table the motion. And the discussion about that was that, well, this is too complicated of an issue for us to make our decision on right now. Mm-hmm. And, of course, tabling a motion means you table it for the balance of the meeting. In other words, now here you have an attorney, the only attorney who's on the county commission board. And here you have an attorney who moves to table a motion, which is essentially didn't know what tabling means, because tabling means you're going to bring it up later on in the meeting. This will never be brought up again. This is the way the county board has started 2012. I think it's a little scary. They've done some other things, which we will talk about next month, but one that, actually two of them that concern me are the ability, they've taken away the board's responsibility to approve expenditures of under $10,000 in lawsuits. So in other words, if the county gets sued and the county administrator and their lawyers decide that we're going to settle it, if it's $9,999.99, it does not have to even come across the desk of the county commissioners, as long as the county administrator huddles with her good buddy, Ken Mahoney, who's the county chairman.
You're wrong on one thing. They did not lose that. They gave it away.
Good point.
They gave that away.
Extremely good point. Extremely good point. Well, we're going to go into that next week in greater detail with County Commissioner Alan Jagger, who I believe he's the one who brought that up. He's interested in communicating to constituents and spending the time and asking the questions. But we now have to look at closing our show here. We will be back, of course, next week. Again, check out the WKBZ website. It's the newstalk1090.com. Lots of links there. You can listen to it live on the computer. And, of course, you can go to my our website, which is iamuskegon.com, and you can listen to it on podcast, listen to it any place with a smartphone or a computer. And also, I am on the Talkin' Muskegon show with John Van Wyk and Brian Worsham. They are on Monday through Friday, 9 to 10. I'm on the show now on Wednesdays and Fridays. Thanks again to Susie. I wish you would have brought all your guns. Well, not all your guns, but some of them would have been kind of cool to see.
Happy to have been here, Jim.
But you've been wonderful. Appreciate it. We will have you back, I hope. I hope you'll come back. And thanks, of course, to Oscar. And we will be talking. We got to talk more about Oscar's business here because I think that's a cool business. Thanks to the whole crew at KBZ. They do a wonderful job here. Next Sunday, as I said, January 15th, we will have County Commissioner Alan Jagger and perhaps some others. We really want to focus on not so much are the decisions right or wrong. I'll, of course, be opinionated as I always am. But are these decisions that the citizens have a right to know about before they're made? And are these decisions that our county commissioners, and I would certainly hope that we could expand this show into the city, our representatives really interested in asking the tough questions and getting the information necessary before they make these tough decisions? And, of course, if you're listening to us, don't forget our new start time. It started a little bit ago, 8:30 in the morning. Stay tuned for Tom Sinaki's Polka Melodies. I hope you all have a great week on our little piece of heaven, folks. Next week, we'll put the eye on you, Muskegon.
You got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes. Well, you dat-gum, dat-gum, dat-gum government. Uh-huh. Oh, don't you know?
At Advance Auto Parts, we don't do anything just part way. We go full throttle.
You made the resolution. Start living healthy today at the Muskegon Family YMCA. Your children can learn to swim while you take popular fitness classes like Zumba or spinning. Don't miss the opportunity to get half off the joint fee when you register by January 10th. Sign up today at 900 West Western in Muskegon, next to Heritage Landing.
Serious about your growing operation? See Green Lantern H2O in Muskegon. They are the only hydroponic and organic growing supply outlet with a certified horticulturist and nurseryman on staff. Stop by today and let the ladies help you grow big. Open 7 days a week. See them today on Laketon Avenue and US 31 across from Checkers. Green Lantern H2O.
The Talk of Muskegon is News Talk 1090, WKBZ Muskegon, and heard 24 hours a day on WOOD HD2 Muskegon.
Supplement combination that's right for you.
Good morning and welcome to the Sunday edition of the Polka Melodies. It's Sunday, January 8th, 2012. It's 10 o'clock this morning, which means the Polka Melodies is on for your enjoyment up until noon today. I'm Tom Sinaki, your West Michigan Polka DJ. We're right here with the Talk of Muskegon and the Polka Melodies on News Talk 1090 WKBZ Muskegon. Good morning.